Welcome to this service. I'm not Darrell. As you can see, Darrell is ill. He's been sick for a good part of this week with a cold, and let me know first thing this morning that he wasn't going to be able to be here. And I know it's a week before Thanksgiving, but I am just feeling so incredibly grateful this morning. We have just an amazing group of people in this church. All of them are amazing. Because I didn't have one single ounce of worry about how this service was going to go. Because I knew that people were going to step in. So as Janet said to us back as we were praying, I don't think anybody's doing the same thing that they were planning on doing today. And I know that you're going to be with us. It's Communion Sunday, and so we celebrate that. Wendy is sick. I'm just so grateful that Jim can step in and play. We have just amazing, talented people. And a lot of people that do things quietly and behind the scenes. So I hope that you just are grateful, as I am, for just the gifts that we have in our congregation. That we can, even without Darrell, that we can still have this. Welcome to any unseen visitors, but is anyone giving a welcome to you? We are going to have coffee afterwards, so we invite you to come back to the service. Come back for coffee after the service. One of the things that I should mention to you, if you're kind of new to church, the people that are going to be stepping up today in the service are deacons. And deacons are kind of volunteers that volunteer to join with Darrell in helping in the leadership, particularly the spiritual leadership of this church. So it's going to be really, if you see people taking responsibility, I want to especially thank John, who's going to be reading Darrell's sermon and taking on a number of different aspects of the service today. So he is a deacon as well. So I thought I should maybe explain that. A couple announcements. One is to acknowledge that today, this afternoon, is the celebration of life for Roland Lawman, and that is from 2 to 4 at the Army and Navy, which is on Water Street. So I just want to acknowledge that. We want to gather names of people in our church. We haven't done any sort of a directory for a while. So what we're asking is that you could provide, just on a slip of paper, your name and whatever you're willing to provide. Whether that's an email, a cell phone, an address. We're not, because of privacy of information, we can't just collect that information without your permission. And so even though we might have that from the past, we want to make sure that you're still okay, that we have your cell phone or whatever it is that you provide. So we're going to be collecting that over the next month or so and ask that you would hand that into the office. Thank you.
Please join us now in the call to worship. O people, approach the unapproachable, stand radiant in God's splendor, and become the children of light. O people, enter into the eternal, stand radiant in God's glory, and become children of the day. Used to identify the honor of a king. Never has there been, nor will there ever be, a king like our Lord, our Savior, our King of heaven, earth, life, and death. So worthy to be crowned with him many crowns. A king is so humble, so full of love and grace, all-powerful and almighty. Please stand as we sing, "Crown him with many crowns." Please remain standing. Grace is being loved and forgiven, even when we don't necessarily deserve it. It is the unmerited favor of God freely given to us all. Please stand as we sing Amazing Grace. This is Amazing Grace.
Yeah. Next, we're reading from Psalm 91. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. Those who love me, I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life, I will satisfy them and show them my salvation.
Please join us now for this new prayer of confession in unison. Have mercy upon us, O God, for sin clings so closely and its burden is great. Because of sin, our hands are at our sides when they should be reached out to the others. Our knees are shaking when we should be standing firm. We are victims of our own misdeeds. We cannot escape sin. Wait on our lips. Through Christ's intercession, lift the burden from us and help us walk in freedom and in strength. Amen.
Let us hear the words of assurance. O Lord, rekindle your spirit within us. Make us burn with your power and love. Increase our faith. Set us ablaze with courage that we might fulfill our calling before you and our neighbors. Not simply because you commanded, but because we demanded of ourselves. Amen. Now we're going to have our time of offering. And I didn't get a chance to talk this morning, so I'm going to kind of fit it in here. So how many students do we have for children's story today, or for kids? We have one there, and okay, we're all set for that. I have a special thing for you today that we wouldn't normally have at Carroll, so we're going to go there. All right. So our offering prayer. And Jay's always here, right? Okay. All that we have and ever hope to have is a gift and a trust from God. The Apostle Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians 4:2 that as stewards of what God has entrusted to us, we only have one responsibility. Paul writes, stewards are expected to show themselves trustworthy. Let us demonstrate that we are worthy of God's trust in giving us worldly goods as we offer God our tithes and offerings.
Okay, we invite the children to come forward with their godly play helpers. And as they come forward, I'm going to tell you what they're doing downstairs today. Come on up to the front here so we can talk and sing with you. Today in Godly Play, they're doing the creation story. So, the introduction is, with this story, we begin to trace the presence and mystery of God. We ask ourselves, when we look at creation, what can we know about the giver by seeing the gift? And as we look at the creation story, we are in awe at the perfect plan our all-powerful, all-knowing, and loving Father had for us, his people. So we're going to sing the song together. I know you know this one because you're a BDS. It's Monumental, and then John's going to talk about children's time.
Okay.
Here's our song.
I couldn't just do it without a mic. No, I'm not going to do it without a mic. I've been told. As you get told by your wives, do you?
I've been told. Well, once in a while.
All in favor?
I mean, so, I had a public service announcement as I come up here. So, hello, where to go?
There we are.
Janet is now doing Girl Guides, brownies, all that kind of thing. So one of the things, one of the perks that comes with that is you get to sell Girl Guide cookies. Yeah, so we haven't seen Girl Guide cookies in quite a while because you don't know where to get them. But we now have somebody that's doing Girl Guide cookies. And if you come back after church today, you might be able to find, I think there's only 8 boxes left.
Trey, Mike.
What's the mic?
Yeah, it's the mic.
Okay. Anyway, so that's coming afterwards, so. That better? No. Hello? Hello, there we go. Okay. We're good, I think. So these ones aren't sold yet. $5 a box. That's not what Children's Story is all about today, but that was just a fun break in the middle there. Okay, so I'm going to do something today that Darrell will not normally do.
Praise the Lord.
Well, no, he might do that, but this is the thing that's going to happen today. So, what? What are these? Raisins! Yes, they're raisins. Okay. All right. So, Darrell doesn't like raisins for whatever reason. So, I'm going to set that there. And I'm going to set that there. What's the difference? One shorter. Maybe. I think they're supposed to be the same size, though. What else do you think? You want some help from the audience? There's a crack in that one. Okay. All right. Any other things? Okay. Turn around and pick somebody to give us an answer. Can you turn around and pick somebody? Oh, lady in the back. Yes. What do you think, Mom? What's the difference?
Oh, I'm not sure. Maybe one's empty.
Oh. You think one could be empty?
Not me.
Do you think so? You think yes? Because moms are almost always right? Not always, but almost always. Yeah, okay. So how can we find out? Oh, but do you eat raisins? Is it okay if he has raisins?
Of course.
Okay. So let's try it and see what we find. That one's empty? Oh. Oh, let's see. Look, are you sure there's raisins in there? Oh, you get to keep them. They're your raisins. Okay. So, that was very good. It's good that we only had one person to take, because we only had one box. But, so, I like raisins, you like raisins, a lot of us like raisins, some people don't like raisins, that's okay. But, the key is that what's inside of us is the important thing, not the outside so much. So God looks at us and he goes, that person's being kind and nice and loving other people and doing that kind of thing. And last week we looked at the Good Samaritan, and it was, people looked at the outside, it was all beat up and ugly, didn't want to deal with them. So when we were at school, sometimes we judge people by what they look like. We hope not, but sometimes we do. So if a person's a good friend, that's what we want to remember, right? That the person's a good friend. So let's just have a little prayer, okay? Thank you, God, that you look at the inside and not the outside. We all look different, but God, help us to be that kind person inside. Give us your strength Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Oh.
I need to say something too. But Ezra's mummy made muffins. So if anyone, if that makes a difference to anyone, then please join us after.
Yes.
We got all kinds of things back there today. I tell you. Plus some really good people going back to visit, and that's the other good thing too. Okay. You think it was that one?
I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them.
And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? So the sermon today is not mine, it's Darrell's. He found time to write it. I know that I'm not a regular preacher because I could never do the stuff that they write it all out and go over it and spend days working on these sermons. I'm much more of an off-the-cuff kind of person. So I can do this today, but I would have a hard time preparing it. One of the things that I find is bits and pieces will be me in this sermon today. This is me. One of the things I find is that when I'm sitting in the congregation, I kind of lose touch with what's happening up here. And so I'm going to ask you to help with the situation today. So if you were to pray for something, what would you, I'm going to give you time to think about it, what would you pray for today during this sermon? Pray for it. You don't want to share what we're going to pray for?
No.
Peace on earth.
Peace on earth.
The people who are listening at home, that they will feel loved.
Thank you for God's love and God's love. Okay.
Back? No? Yes? No? Yeah.
Pray for faith for those that are struggling to find it.
Okay.
The women in Iran.
Yeah.
Understanding that we know how to apply it to our lives.
Good too. Am I gonna pray for me? Thank you. So, when we were stopped to think about what things should we be praying for, most important things. And I remember going to conferences, and one of the things that they said is, when you are at this conference, what is it that God wants you to get out of it? You've spent your money, you've traveled a long distance, you've come to this place. What is it that God wants you to get? The person beside you might be getting something totally different than you are. And that's okay, because God deals with us differently to where we are. And with the prayers that you spoke about today, each one of you comes from a different place and different, and worried about different things. Some people are concerned about people in other parts of the world. Some people are concerned about people right now. Some people are concerned that, I hope I get something out of the sermon today. So we will find out, hopefully, if those things happen. So I'm not sure if we're going to find out exactly what's going to happen in the other part of the world when we're done sermon today, but hopefully, when we're done today, hopefully you'll get something out of it for you. You will find out that God has touched you in a different way now than what you're like at the end of the sermon, at the end of the service. Here we go. Thank you, Darrell, for putting all this work in, and I hope you get better soon, too. I'm not sure I can tell jokes the same way that Darrell does. We will see. We'll see how that goes. No event, and certainly no story, comes out of the vacuum. There's always something that prompted the creation of the story, or even more important for today, the remembering of the story. One of the very important questions we need to ask ourselves when we are reading and contemplating in our scripture is simply this: why this story? Why, out of all of what were likely many stories and lessons Jesus taught, was this one why this one persevered, why did Luke think it important? And who are our characters today? We have the
judge.
We have the
widow.
The widow. Just the two people, right? And the widow's asking for justice. And the judge is not a very kind judge, but he's going to grant her justice because she's persistent. She keeps asking. Well, some may ask in context, back in the early church, the scattered groups of believers were becoming discouraged. They had expected Jesus to return quickly, but so far he hadn't shown up. At least not in bodily form. The original 12 disciples were dying off, and even the second generation of the followers were getting old. Persecution had taken its toll, too. It seemed that everything Jesus had predicted had happened, and the second coming of Christ should have followed soon after the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. But here they were, still waiting and watching for Jesus to come again in glory. The stories that had been told with such urgency a generation ago were now losing their shine. Some of the details became fuzzy, and still Jesus did not come. Had they missed it somehow? Had they misunderstood? Sure, they had heard him announce that there would be persecution, and they had suffered through that terrible experience. As the church had spread from Jerusalem to Antioch, and from there along the Mediterranean coast, the people who now call themselves Christians struggled to maintain an identity that contrasted strongly with the culture around them. Sometimes it got pretty confusing. As the number of disciples who had seen Jesus and heard him teach continued to dwindle, many were getting discouraged that Jesus might never return, as he had promised. In the middle of all this confusion and discouragement, Luke set out to tell the whole story of the good news, to refresh everyone's memory and put events in their proper perspective. He addressed a primary Gentile audience, drawing on the stories that had never been told over and over again, arranging them in an order that was designed to encourage believers to keep on believing. Luke wrote down the facts he knew and used his best editing skills to help Christians understand those facts in the light of God's timeline. The kingdom of God that had been introduced to the world in the person of Jesus Christ is already at work, but not yet fulfilled. Luke wanted his readers to know that Jesus had not broken his promise to return, but that waiting for a second coming required more than sitting around in an upper room. It meant actively participating in the work of the kingdom. In today's passage, Luke explains the parable of Jesus before sharing the parable itself. He only does this two other times, that when we read about the Pharisee and the tax collector, and the others, the story of the 10 talents. But the explanation that Luke gives helps us focus our attention on the importance of staying persistently connected to God. And we suggest we actually start at the end of the passage and work our way backwards to the beginning to make sense of this parable. The question Jesus asks at the conclusion of the story actually gives us a perspective for understanding it that we might not see if we are in a hurry to read on to the next passage. So let's look backward first to reflect on the story of the persistent widow and the unjust judge from the framework of this question, When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? Which is how our scripture passage ended. Jesus started this particular teaching back in chapter 17, verse 20, when the Pharisees asked him when the kingdom of God was coming. He tells them the kingdom of God is not coming with things that can be observed, nor will they say, look, here it is, or there it is, for in fact the kingdom of God is among you. Jesus often closed his teaching speeches with parables. So the story about the unjust judge and the persistent widow serves as a final close to this longer lecture about the coming of God's kingdom on earth. The final question makes sense in light of this bigger picture. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? The Pharisees had asked when, but Jesus answers that how we wait is much more important than knowing the exact moment. He throws his question back at the Pharisees. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? In other words, will we be faithful to the end? This is the crux of the matter. Will Jesus find faithfulness, trustworthiness among his people when he comes again? Whenever that may be. Let us go back a step further. Before Jesus asks if we will be faithful, he assures us that God can always be trusted. God is faithful, Jesus says, and will not grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him, and will he not grant justice to those who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. Do you notice how Luke reminds us through the words of Jesus of this tension in the first century where Christians were feeling the tension between the expected suddenness of Christ's second coming and the perceived delay of that event? God will not put off helping his people. But God does not operate in our timeline. We've been waiting for 2,000 years, so evidently he does not work in our timeline. As Peter would write to another group of early Christians, do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promises, some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any of you to perish, but to come to repentance. We today should also be encouraged that God will give justice. God will make things right that were wrong. God will surely heal what is broken. But God's patience should not be seen as procrastination. God is showing mercy, giving us time to turn to him and seek forgiveness, to ask him to make us whole. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? Recent headlines might make you wonder if it's possible. There's plenty that is wrong, broken in our world today as much as it was over 2,000 years ago. Justice sometimes seems like a dream more than a possible reality. We see disappointment and pain every day as people are murdered and others go without food and adequate shelter. Leaders turn out to be corrupt, governments stop functioning, and self-serving greed has a higher social value than generosity towards others. The unjust judge for this parable would fit right in today's world. He doesn't fear God and has no respect for people, but yet he's the judge. He models the exact opposite of the great commandment to love God and love neighbor. I can think of a few people in the news who sound just like this judge. And I'm sure it wouldn't take long for you to make the list either. The judge only gives justice to get rid of the widow's annoyance. Not because he cares about right and wrong. Yet, because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice. He says, so that she may not wear me out by continually coming to see me. Now, I'm not thinking that we should be going down to the courthouse and, you know, we're waving our signs and pickets and thinking that the judge is going to change his mind. But in the context of the story, that's how it worked. What the New Revised Standard Version gives us is, wear me out. Other translations offer it as, shame me. So these are all the things that the judge is thinking that she's going to wear me out, she's going to shame me. Quite literally, however, he would translate this phrase to me, so she won't slap me in the face. I don't think that's really what she was going to do, but that's how it's translated. Or, so she won't give me a black eye. I don't think the judge is too worried about that poor widow doing that either. Now, the judge wants to avoid being embarrassed or shamed by the widow's constant badgering. It is that very badgering, that continual showing up on his doorstep to ask for justice, that finally allows the widow to win over the unethical judge. Let's take a look at what that widow from the story said, where Jesus says, in that city there was a widow who kept coming to him saying, grant me justice against my opponent. We don't know who the opponent is, or what the problem the widow has. We only know that she is seeking justice. And she has her speech down to 6 words. Persistently, day after day, this woman kept coming to them and saying, grant me justice against my opponent. What else could she do? The judge is her only hope. You see, most women in that day were very young. They were barely teenagers when they got married. So the possibility of outliving their husbands was a very strong one. There were many widows, but they weren't necessarily old. They weren't necessarily old women. The problem was that they often had no means of support when their husbands died, especially if they had no sons to take responsibility for them, to care for them. They did not inherit their husband's estate. It went to another male member of the family. Very thankful that we live in a culture that we knew. If a widow stayed with her husband and family, she became little more than a servant of the household. If she went back to her own family, the bride price had to be paid back to the husband's family. Many times, widows were sold as slaves to pay off their husband's debts. With all this in mind, it is a wonder this widow even tried to seek justice. Yet here she is, day after day, relentlessly asking an unjust judge to give her justice against her opponent. She didn't have a whole lot of social weight behind her. How much more will God give justice to those who ask him? Jesus kept saying. If a crooked judge can be convinced to do what is right, even if it's for the wrong reasons, how much more will God show mercy to those he loves? And how are we back at the beginning? And now we are back at the beginning with the reason Luke gives us for this parable of Jesus. Then Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. Many times I think we focus on the first part of that explanation and ignore the last part. Jesus was not only teaching the disciples the importance of prayer, he was urging them not to lose heart. And when we see the problems in the world and all the things that are going on, it's sometimes easy to forget that God is doing things in his time. And we do lose heart. Jesus knew that they would each have to face what he would have, that they would have to face after he was gone, and he wanted to make sure that they were prepared for what was to come. Luke uses these words of Jesus to remind his readers, decades later, they should also not lose heart as they wait for Jesus to come again. And he wrote them down so that other believers, centuries later, could also be encouraged. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? Certainly, Luke spends a lot of ink describing the importance of prayer. Jesus holds up this persistent widow as a model for effective prayer. But he isn't talking about mindlessly repeating the same prayers over and over again. The persistence in prayer, Jesus asks us, is a faithful pursuit of God's justice in the world. This widow's six-word prayer was new and fresh each time she said it. She might have used the same words over and over again, but she meant each one of them every single time with the same intensity and focus she used from the beginning of her campaign. Do we pray like that? Praying is nothing more or less than pouring out our hearts to God, who will always be faithful to hear us. It means trusting in God and not in ourselves. It means constantly hoping for the time when God will make things right, convinced that God's justice will prevail over evil. Just as the widow kept coming to the judge, determined relentlessly, hoping against all odds, we are to keep praying. Determined, relentless, hoping against all odds, not because we are good Christians, or because our faith is strong, but because God's Holy Spirit has given us the courage to pray without ceasing in a broken and scary world. That God's kingdom will come, and God will shall be done. God's will shall be done. If we are to be found faithful when the Son of Man comes, we must keep praying and not lose heart. And what is it that we should pray for? The widow gets it right. Our prayers must be for justice. Our petty desires are what we think we need, for God already knows what we need before we ask. And many times that God knows that what God knows we need and what we think we need are not always the same. We are to pray for God's kingdom to come and God's will to be done. We must not lose heart, for becoming weary with waiting for Christ to come again to deliver us once and for all from the pain and brokenness we see all around us, we must persist in hope, persist in prayer, and persist in seeking justice until the Lord comes. Christ's coming may yet be in the future, but God's patience is at work now. The parable assures us that God will save his people. The concern is not when this will happen, it's certainly, but the necessity for us to live in readiness and faithfulness is an important thing. Will Jesus come again as he promised? Absolutely. Will God bring justice to the world? Without a doubt. Will we be faithful until that time, pursuing justice and working for the kingdom of God? If we pray constantly, relentlessly, persistently, for God to do his mighty work among us, it may be so. So, here's the challenge. the letter from James, we read, "Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed." The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. And Jesus said, "For there where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Many of you have experienced the power of prayer in your lives. I have heard stories of people in this church coming together to pray. And we're going to do that in a minute. I have heard stories of people and the way God answered those prayers. Can you think of a time in our history when we needed prayer more than we do now? The needs I see in this town are great. And there's so little help available to meet some of those needs. People struggle to make ends meet, to battle addiction, to find purpose and meaning in their lives. The greatest need that Darrell sees is I see for Jesus to be Lord of their life. For God's love is to be made known to people who have never experienced it. Isn't that something worth praying for? Isn't that something worth praying for together? We found, and he's got a little blurry here. It says, "He found an old Franciscan benediction that spells this out beautifully." It's a poem. "May God bless you with discomfort, at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer pain, rejection, hunger, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and turn their pain to joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in the world, so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. To bring justice and kindness to all our children and the poor. Amen." So, before we do our congregational prayer, I would like you to turn. I know some people don't like to pray out loud, and I get it. But if you would find somebody to sit with and think of one thing to pray for, if you go ahead and do that. I'll give you some time. If you want to sit there and just pray quietly, you can do that too. If you don't feel comfortable. Okay. And then I'll close in a minute.
Let us pray. God, we pray that you might not be faithful. All these prayers that people have said today, they're things that you have put upon their hearts that we should be remembering, that we should be praying for. Concerns that we have of this world, the justice in this world that we need to seek out and we need to do. We don't feel we have the strength to make change or to bring out justice, to bring justice into the world. And God, with your strength, we pray that we might do these things. That you might give us the wisdom to know in which ways we can do what you want to have done. And we thank you for the people in this place and the way that you will work through us. For Christ our Savior, it was you who sensed the danger of depending on others but did not hesitate to brave that danger. It was you who knew intimately the pain of rebuking friends but did not hesitate to risk that pain. It was you, loving Lord, who counted the cost of discipleship, but did not hesitate to pay the cost. Oh, how we adore you. You are our Lord, before whom we bow in awe and gratitude, and our teacher, to whom we turn in need and expectation. As you have taught us the meaning of lordship, teach us now the meaning of discipleship. Teach us what it means to be members not simply of the church, but of your body. This is not our first time that we have approached you as disciples seeking guidance. We have approached you many times, and each time you heeded our request, but we did not always heed your counsel. You urge us to honor those who serve God by sharing their faith, but we coveted the honor for ourselves. You reminded us to warn others against the consequences of evil deeds, but we feared the scorn of evildoers. You exhorted us to treat all other people alike in the world as in the church, but we played favorites in the church as in the world. You have never failed us, Lord. We have failed. So we come to you asking for another chance. Not a second, third, or fourth, or a number that is beyond our remembering. We ask for the grace to hear and to heed your voice. For the fortitude to comfort and correct our friends, for the determination to respect and rely on others, and for the courage to count and to pay the cost of discipleship. We are not ignorant of the demands of discipleship. We have not done justice by our knowledge. Help us, O Christ, to do as well as we know, and better yet, to do the greater work you promised we would do. Rekindle within us the gift of God. Stir within us the spirit of power. Bless us in faith and love. We proclaim your truth. In Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn today is called O Sacred Head, Our Lord.
This one is into communion today. Please stand in front of us. Thank you.
On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered together with his disciples, his close friends. And he took some bread from the table. And he broke it. And he gave thanks. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's thank God for this bread, a symbol of Christ's body broken for us.
Let us pray. O God, we ask to bless and sanctify this bread to the souls of all those who partake of this, that they may, in remembrance of the body of thy Son, and witness unto thee, O God. Amen.
Let's eat this bread in the remembrance of Christ's body and death. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took wine, in this case, grape juice, which is a common household drink. And he took this bread and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink in remembrance of me. Let us thank God for this drink, a symbol of God's blood poured out for us.
Let us pray. Thank you, God, for the reminder. The reminder of what you did for us and for this world. Help us to seek justice. Help us to have the strength to do the things that you know we should do and that we know we should do. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. It gives us the ability to do the things that we can't do on our own. Thank you for your shed blood in our behalf, on our behalf. Amen.
Let's drink together in remembrance of Christ's blood.
Where pain is wrong and mercy fills the
with integrity of heart, seeking God and scorning evil, loving good and loathing corruption, rendering justice and righting wrong. Let us walk confidently in the power of heaven, remembering one another constantly in our prayers, and honoring one another continually with our lives. As Scripture says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith?